This is Duke University Chapel.
Grace and peace to you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and welcome to Duke University Chapel. It's always a privilege to join with you in worship here at the chapel, and we pray that each of you will meet God in this place. We have terrific news to report from the Habitat House that's being built by the Duke Student Chapter and members of the congregation, which is less than 2 miles from the spot where I'm standing now. As of yesterday afternoon, the walls are all up, and it was only the first day of construction, so progress is well underway. That means we'll be working each Saturday until the home is, which is really a duplex, will be completed, and we'll need your help. You'll see how to sign up for the list of volunteers in our bulletin. Now, as you review your bulletin, I encourage you to take a careful look at all the announcements there. You'll find a list of engaging activities and opportunities that may impact your life in ways that you never imagined. And now please stand as we lift our voices in song.
Thank you. word of God is living and active, sharper than a two-edged sword. It is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. Let us therefore confess our sins with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace. We have lived as if there were no Christmas, acting as if you were far away and didn't care. Lord, have mercy. We have lived as if there were no Good Friday, crucifying you again in our thoughts and words and deeds. Christ, have mercy. We have lived as if there were no Easter, shrouding ourselves in suspicion and fear and despair. Lord, have mercy. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us share with one another the peace we have found in Christ.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination, which is printed in your bulletin. God, our judge and Savior, teach us in the reading of your word to be open to your truth and to trust in your love, so that we may live each day with confidence in salvation, which is given through Jesus Christ, our Lord. The appointed psalm for today is Psalm 22, verses 1 to 18, found on pages 752 to 753 of your hymnal. The Gloria is printed in your bulletin. Please remain seated and sing the psalm and the Gloria responsively. My God, why have you forsaken me? Oh my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer. Yet you, the praise of Israel, are enthroned in holiness. To you they cried and were saved. But I am a worm and not human. All they who see me mock at me. He committed his cause to the Lord. Let the Lord deliver him. Let the Lord rescue him, for the Lord delights in him. Upon you I was cast from my birth. And since my mother bore me, you have been my God. Amen.
Many bulls encompass me. Strong bulls of Bashan surround me. I am poured out like water. My heart is like wax. My mouth is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue cleaves to my jaws. Indeed, dogs surround me. I can count all my bones. They divide my garments among them. Glory be to the Father and to the Son. As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be.
The Old Testament lesson is from Job, the 23rd chapter. Then Job answered, "Today also my complaint is bitter. His hand is heavy despite my groaning. Oh, that I knew where I might find him, that I might come even to his dwelling. I would lay my case before him and fill my mouth with arguments. I would learn what he would answer me and understand what he would say to me. Would he contend with me in the greatness of his power? No, but he would give heed to me. There an upright person could reason with him, and I should be acquitted forever by my judge. If I go forward, he is not there, or backward, I cannot perceive him. On the left he hides, and I cannot behold him. I turn to the right, but I cannot see him. God has made my heart faint. The Almighty has terrified me. If only I could vanish in darkness, and thick darkness would cover my face." This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you.
The New Testament lesson is from Hebrews, 4th chapter. Indeed, the Word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing until it divides soul from spirit, joints from marrow. It is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And before him no creature is hidden, but all are naked and laid bare to the eyes of the one to whom we must render an account. Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who is in every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. My brothers and sisters, if anyone among you wanders from the truth and is brought back by another, you should know that whoever brings back a sinner from wandering will save the sinner's soul from death and will cover a multitude of sins. This is the word of the Lord.
Gospel lesson is from Mark, the 10th chapter. As Jesus was setting out on a journey, a man ran up and knelt before him and asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. You shall not defraud. Honor your father and mother." He said to him, "Teacher, I have kept all these since my youth." Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said, "You lack one thing. Go, sell what you own and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me." When he heard this, he was shocked and went away grieving, for he had many possessions. Then Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard it will be for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God." And the disciples were perplexed at these words. But Jesus said to them again, "Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God." They were greatly astounded and said to one another, "Then who can be saved?" Jesus looked at them and said, "For mortals it is impossible, but not for God. For God, all things are possible." Peter began to say to him, "Look, we have left everything and followed you." Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother, or father, or children, or fields, for my sake and for the sake of the good news, who will not receive 100-fold now in this age, houses, brothers and sisters, mothers and children, and fields with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last will be first. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated. First, she lost her job. If only it had stopped there, but it didn't. It wasn't only about the money. In the days that followed, her friends scattered. Her husband fell into a terrible sadness. Her daughter was going through a difficult time. She was too downtrodden to offer any help to her own child, and then the bills began to mount in a way they never had before. What was to become of her? What had happened to the life she once knew? Just how far would the unraveling go? The book of Job walks with us into the valley of pain, straight through the searching mystery of faith and suffering. Job shines a light into the crevices we hope we never have to look in, and often don't until it is pressed upon us. Because it is considered part of the wisdom literature of the Old Testament, the life of Job beckons us to distill the wisdom of someone who suffers as much as he does. Today's reading walks on the most tender ground of pain. This is the ground where questions are asked that wouldn't be asked otherwise, where there's no hiding from the hurt, where we ask God questions that aren't polite. Why, God? Why? In the land of Uz, there is a man named Job. He is wealthy and respected, the greatest of all the people in the East. And he is a man of faith, offering prayers and sacrifices to God. Then he loses it all. His 7 children die. His donkeys and sheep and cattle and oxen are taken away. He becomes physically sick, covered with sores on his skin. Job's 3 friends arrive to comfort him. They are practicing what Jews call sitting Shiva, the customary way of sharing lament or loss with a loved one. They sit with him in dust on the ground for 7 days before anyone says a word. Have you ever sat together with someone looking at the inexplicable? It's not easy to do. After the silence, Job's friends speak words of explanation and challenge. It's not very helpful, though, because they encourage Job to assume that the suffering is his fault, the result of his own wrongdoing, and therefore deserved punishment from God. Job maintains that he's done nothing to deserve such a degree of pain. In total despair, Job breaks into a long, loud cry of lament to God. Today, he says, my complaint is bitter. Oh, that I knew where I might find God. He would give heed to me. If only I could vanish in darkness and thick darkness cover my face. How will it all end? Will it ever end? This is the valley of pain. What I want to talk about today is the mystery of the seemingly endless, frighteningly unstoppable, devastating pain of the kind Job encounters. It can't be explained or understood. I'm talking about the kind of suffering where our lives are taken out of our hands. When something happens and the circumstances of our lives are significantly changed, our health, our finances, our hopes for the future, our family composition or responsibilities, the loss of someone we never imagined living without, something for which no preparation could possibly equip us. But it doesn't have to mean death. It could simply mean that our lives are never going to be the same. Sometimes it's someone's fault. Sometimes it's no one's fault. And sometimes we can't really know. But even if we did know, the pain simply refuses to be explained or understood. It just won't go away. Learning to live by faith doesn't happen if we spend our lives surrounded by soft pillows in a neatly ordered world where we think we generally know what God is up to, and we're generally confident we could explain what God is doing. Learning to live by faith happens when we are desperately squinting to see God and His hopes for us. Very often, wisdom comes as we tread the raw ground of human pain. Job's lament and suffering is a meditation on what happens, or what can happen, when we are in such a place. Think about what happens when we encounter this kind of pain. Keep walking, keep talking, just keep moving. Sitting still is too excruciating. I can't do it. Crying, wailing, falling to our knees, tearing our clothes, throwing something, lying face down flat on the floor, unable to speak. Just let me collapse in a heap on the ground. I can't keep going. Job does it all. It is easy for Job's lament to send us into a dizzy set of questions about why. Why, God? Why do you let me hurt? Job is a man deeply respected for his faith, and yet he suffers terribly. because the pain is just so hard to bear. Of course, we reach for consoling answers. I'm sure God sent this to teach me a lesson. Or, I know I'm going to be a stronger person because of this. While these answers come from a good place, they simply aren't enough. We ask the questions that start with why, I believe, when we are afraid of what the pain might do to us. But the truth is, pain does change us. No one who suffers greatly is the same person they were before. So the question for people of faith is, in the midst of this, could God be making something possible? Is there a place where I am being made more like God? Could there be deeper grace in God than I have known before? Whether it is happening to us or to someone we care about, the experience of suffering sends us to search our storehouse for ways to help or cope or survive. It's as if there's something within us saying, if I'm experiencing this much pain, then something must be wrong with me. Or if I'm experiencing this much pain, then something is wrong with God. And this is because it is so hard to simply let the pain be. Why are we so afraid of much hurt and many tears? Because pain, I believe, reveals what's inside a Pandora's box we don't really want to open. There are a lot of fears inside that box. We're afraid our hurting will obliterate us. We assume it probably leads to death, or at least to a life of isolation that's very much like death because it's so lonely. We're afraid that if we're overcome with pain, we'll simply cease to be. We're worried that underneath it all, we do deserve whatever has befallen us because God knows the truth of our waywardness, and surely we have to pay a price. I want to place you in the shoes of a woman here in Durham. She stood at the side of a street. Around her gathered friends, family, and neighbors. Some of the faces she recognized, some she had never seen before. She knew they had come to remember her daughter. They stood together in a circle at the place where her daughter died. Her daughter had been murdered 3 months earlier. Police had a suspect, but no arrests. All she knew was that her daughter died from multiple gunshot wounds. Someone spoke her daughter's name. Someone else read a psalm and then offered a prayer. Someone said it was time to share memories of this young woman's life. She wanted to say something about her daughter. What she really wanted everyone to know was how much she loved her child. She began to speak and got through only a few words. And then she wept. She couldn't keep going. She couldn't say another word. There was silence. It was a most holy silence. No one said anything or moved. Until she looked up and saw another woman walking step by step, by step, by step, slowly but confidently towards her with arms open wide, She felt arms wrapped around her. She was held, and she cried more. The woman who embraced her said, "My son died a year ago the same way." That was all that needed to be said. In that moment, the two mothers embracing drew the circle more closely together. With God, something is possible in the hidden crevices of pain that remains elusive to us when we keep a safe distance. But it happens only when the cries can be sounded loudly and without restraint. When the cushions of life are well stuffed, we don't worry about these things so much. But when the cushions are snatched away and we're sitting in dust and ashes, God may be transforming us in ways that wouldn't be possible otherwise. Job's lament comes from the place where he admits he can't comprehend God. Think for a moment about the people you know who have given you some true wisdom to help you along. Chances are these are people who have lived without the cushions in one way or another. They've known what it means to pick up the phone at 3 a.m. and hear terrifying news. They've received an unexpected diagnosis. They've experienced unimaginable disappointment. In these times, they learned that the life of faith is not to be found on our well-plotted map of how we plan on living with God. Living by faith is so much more than that. And we are blessed by the presence of those who, like Job, show us another way. Pain takes us to the very center of the gospel. The cry of Job in his despair is the cry of Jesus on the cross. It is Psalm 22, which has been on our lips this morning. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me from the words of my groaning? Oh my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night, but find no rest. Remember Job's lament. If I go forward, he is not there, or backward, I cannot perceive him. On the left, he hides, and I cannot behold him. I turn to the right, but I cannot see him. The desperation of need is so much, so immense, so beyond what we usually give ourselves permission to acknowledge. It is raw need. Those who cry in their suffering, "My God, why have you forsaken me?" echo this cry of the Son to the Father. It almost feels profane to say this cry is within God, within the Holy Trinity, but it is. It is deep within the relationship between the Father and the Son. We can ask where God was when Jesus was on the cross, or we can ask why God lets Job weep in ashes. But these questions keep us from thinking about what the unabashed cry of the Son to the Father is really all about. It becomes hard to actually hear the cry. So for a moment, let go of the why. Let go of the why and just hear the cry with me now. Hear it in yourself or in the life of someone you care about. Listen until you really hear. My God, oh, that I knew where I might find you. I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night, but find no rest. Let go of the why and hear the cry. My God, if I knew where I might find you, I would come even to your dwelling. Do not be far from me, for trouble is near, and there is no one to help. That's lament. That is the lament that draws humble humanity and true divinity together. It is humanity seeking in God what only God can be, and searching in God for what only God can do. That's what this cry is really about. Job's insistence on crying to God is a guide to us in our own distress. For Job, there is nothing outside of God to save him, and nothing outside of God to comfort him. That's his faithfulness. He insists that all he seeks can only be found in God. Lament is an act of faith for this one reason. It means casting all our hope upon God. This cry gave birth to the church. This cry is still giving birth to the church today. By God's grace, could this valley of lament and pain become a gift? When we, through our own dark night, cry out to God, it is an invitation to the church to live in ways that make isolation impossible. The cries may be profanely raw, the ground may be infinitely tender, the crevices deep, and the valley long. But my brothers and sisters in faith, the pain will not mean isolation. It will never mean we must be alone. It will never be the end of us. I want you to know that if you are in that kind of a place right now, your cries belong in the church, and God has a place for you among his people. Imagine, just imagine, a life where no matter what someone is going through, no matter how inexplicable or frightening or difficult it may be, we can together be the household of God. Maybe you can't explain what God is up to. Maybe God isn't following your well-plotted map. Maybe the cushions have been snatched away from you. If you feel God has abandoned you, then abandon yourself to God. That's right, abandon. Cast yourself upon God and hold nothing back. Cast it all upon the Lord, everything. Keep nothing in reserve as precaution in case God doesn't come through. That's what God did for you. God held nothing back in Jesus. God gave up everything to live among us, and Jesus wholly abandoned everything to save us. He has cast his very life with us. He has shown us holy abandon. That's what Job does. He shows us holy abandon. So, holy abandon yourself to God. Amen.
God has placed his life in our hands. Let us proclaim our faith that we place our lives in his hands. We stand for the creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Holy God, in Christ you wholly abandoned yourself to us. Embrace those who feel wholly abandoned. Be close to all who walk the long road of mental illness, especially those who find it hard to sustain relationships of permanence and trust. Be our companion when we feel abandoned in grief, when we yearn for words of comfort but find them hard to hear. Speak to the hearts of all who feel abandoned in faith and a long way from your intimate touch. Bring succor to those who are in physical pain and know it is only going to get worse. In a moment of silence, we bring to you one person we know who feels abandoned by you. Give us grace to abandon ourselves to you in the secret places of our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Beckoning God, in Jesus, you called the rich man to enter your Father's kingdom. When you call us like him to go, give us courage to travel, to risk, to change. When you call us like him to sell, fill us with joy as you make our lives simpler that others may simply live. When you call us like him to give, bring us friends we never knew we could make and wise guides we never thought we could meet. When you call us like him to come, keep us faithful to your commandments and set us on fire with love for you. And when you call us like him to follow, instill us with humility to accept the guidance of others and the patience to walk in step with you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Wondrous God, in Jesus we discover that nothing is impossible with you. Encourage all who face mountainous debts, especially those for whom mortgage payments are an unbearable burden. Bless organizations in our city that provide capital for first-time homeowners and small businesses, and prosper the work of those building the Habitat Home on Moorhead Avenue. Shelter all who know they have done something terribly wrong and can't face the pain of those they have scarred and wounded or the shame of showing their face in public. Cherish all whose dreams have been shattered and uphold their tender hearts, that they may learn to dream again. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Be with us, Lord, in grief, in despair, in temptation, in pain and in fear, and give us strength, whate'er betide us, to bear us through the evil days, that even when the clouds gather above us and the earth shake beneath us, we can look to the wounded hands of your Son and the sustaining grace of your Holy Spirit and say, it is well with my soul. Amen. Because help is near, we need never be afraid. So let us make our offering in wonder, love, and praise.
eternal God, the source of all life and the light of all seeing, accept our thanks and praise for all you have done for us. We glorify your name for the splendor of your world, for the life of faith which gives us hope, and for those who have stood by us in the best of times and the worst of times. We give thanks for this university and for all who study and work in this place. Today we remember especially the Department of Sociology at Duke and their study of human societies. May their efforts contribute to increased understanding of the world around us and be applicable to the pursuit of a better society. As we return to you now the fruits of our labors, we thank you most of all for your gracious presence with us, ever-living God, ground and source of every good, and for being with us in times of fear and doubt, as well as in times of happiness and peace. With all your people in every corner of creation, we count it joy to praise your name, both now and forevermore. Amen. And now let us pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now go forth in peace, and may God's face shine upon us. May Christ's peace rule among us, and may the Spirit's fire burn deep within us. Amen.